Art Blitz. I'm your host, Matt Gleason. My guest, I'm going to say painter, and he'll correct me if he prefers to be called artist, but painter Rafael Serrano. Welcome. Awesome. Welcome to the show, man.
Painter, now, photographer.
Painter, photographer.
Yeah, and photographer, I should
but
say.
But not artist.
Artist sounds all right, except nowadays everybody calls themselves artists.
Yeah, I mean, that's a good point. So, you are an LA mainstay. You have been in the LA scene as long as I can remember, and I've been around forever. When did you get into, were you an practicing artist before you came to LA, or did you come to LA and then start?
Well, I came to LA when I was 12 years old, and I was involved in the arts since childhood, though I come from a medical family. Everybody's a doctor in my family. I was doing art since childhood. Both my parents used to paint.
Exhibit or just paint?
No, my father was a dermatologist, and my brother's a neurologist, and et cetera. One other artist, my oldest brother, half-brother, but they did not exhibit. My oldest brother perhaps did a little bit in New York.
When was your first exhibit?
My first exhibit, major exhibit, was actually curated by Howard Fox of the LA County Museum.
Okay,
it was a group show, though. It was at LACPS.
Oh, wow. That's going way back.
Yeah, that does. And then it went from there to a few months later, it ended up at the LA County Museum.
So it started at LACPS, moved to LACMA.
Well, I'm the only one who did, actually. I met him through this show that he had. It was curated. And then he brought me into this exhibit at LACMA. Within a few months, which was a big leap in my career.
What year was this?
This was the exhibit at LA, it was for 1986 at LACPS, and the LACMA, it was Avant Garde in the 80s in 1987.
Oh, it was a great show. You were in that?
Yes, I was part of that. And I was actually, besides myself, I called my mother, I remember.
I was just a young, I can call anybody and tell them that you were in an important show. So is this a new work?
This is from last year, yes.
What are you up to now?
I am basically doing stuff along these lines. I do this, they're painting collages, though this is a rather large painting collage.
How big is it?
This is about 3 by 4 feet, which is not humongous. I used to paint much bigger back in the 80s, but you know, substantially bigger than my small collages, which are 16 by 20, 20 by 24.
What was it about the 80s and big painting? Why? There was just so much big painting.
It was the thing. My paintings were 8 feet back then, on average. I don't know, it was an ego trip, I guess.
Casual comment is the truth. Wow, yeah. That was a good one.
My studio was humongous back then. I had 5,000 square feet, of which I mostly partied in and didn't do a hell of a lot of artwork. I mean, I used only a corner of it. The rest of it was just to show off. It was very inexpensive, of course.
Now that's changed, right?
Oh yeah, right. You know, my studio in recent history has been a bit quarter, and I mean, it's really minuscule compared to what I had back then. But yet, I produce more interesting work now than I did even back then, I think.
What are we looking at here?
This is also a collage, painting collage. It's considerably smaller. It's about 16 by 20.
Is this on paper?
It's on paper. And what I do is I have a tendency to this is about four generations of work. I start with a small painting, and then I photograph it, and then I Photoshop it, and I play around with it. I don't change the forms, but I change the color rendition. Sometimes I reverse it. Then I print it, and then I repaint over it and recollage over it. And so out of one piece, I usually get three or four pieces. And sometimes lately I've been blowing them quite large and then reworking them.
So you're using digital, but you're using it's a tool to get you back to the
object. It's a tool to look at things differently, to see other possibilities, which, you know, the old masters probably did, but they did it much slower. They had to like repaint or redo.
And I mean, mid-century, to do something like that, you'd have to like take LSD or something to see something, you know, I mean. But you can do anything with the, I mean, you could play around with an infinite number of ways, right?
Yeah, I guess. But the computer has shown me a myriad of other possibilities.
But the end result for you is always that creation of an illusionistic space, right? It's not about digital. You don't want to do.
I don't like the digital. No. I never paint digitally or anything like that. I don't even like the way those things look. I like the tactile. I like the hands on. I like the visceral quality of things. Though I do sometimes paint over my prints. But I repaint the hell out of them, and I recollage over them.
We're not talking digital prints, though. Are you screen prints?
Or no, we're talking digital prints.
You will do a digital output and then paint on it.
Oh, yeah.
But there's no psychology or concept there of digital. You're just using it as a point of departure.
Right.
Okay, so you are a painter.
Oh, I am, okay. Pretty much. Pretty much hands-on, yeah.
Okay. And when did you get your first computer that you wanted to
use? I'm not all that computer savvy anyway. I'm quite primitive when it comes to it.
Like people who know Photoshop too well can't
I'm primitive.
You could make a mistake in Photoshop that a pro would never make, but the mistake would actually be something visually interesting, right?
Yeah, for me to be considered a computer savvy, like really, it's ridiculous. All I do is I document my work. In some ways, I'm technically quite versed as a painter, as a photographer, because that's my background, and as a seer, so, I mean, a visionary. I can see things that a lot of people can't even come close to seeing, perhaps. But the computer technology aspect of it only goes as far as like I photograph my work. I see other possibilities with changing colors and
darks
renditions,
and
darks and lights, and reversing it, and then as such, I see from that point of departure, which is very simple, really. Anybody can do that. I see a lot of other possibilities, and then I print it, and then I start visualizing, and then of course I collage over it. I cutouts, and out of these cutouts, metamorphose into different things and shapes and animalistic little things. And
have you always? I mean, collage kind of gets a bad rap. I think collage, to me, I think it's a sophisticated medium, but there's some parts of it that are so easy that I think too many of the wrong kind of people started making collages.
I think yours are
a level or two more sophisticated, of course. Were you always a collage artist?
No, not at all. I sort of discovered, I've done, everyone in art school has played around with collage at one time or another. I was never interested really in it until recently, as of maybe 2011, 2012, when I started really getting back into my career, because I should mention this, for like 12 years I disappeared.
Really?
Yeah. I
Where'd you go?
I had inherited some money. I had and I had a name for myself. I was in the LA Times, written up in the LA Times about 7 times during the course of 2 years in the late 80s, early 90s, and it went to my head, and I became a party animal, and I just forgot about painting and taking pictures. I thought, I can always come back. I was enjoying myself, my life. I became self-destructive a little bit, partying, and I had a blast, I have to admit, but it really destroyed my career for a while. People were coming up to me and asking me what's going on with you. And I said, nothing, just I'll get back to next year. So there was a big time lapse. So when I got back to doing my work, which is roughly, not about 7 years ago, perhaps, or 8 years ago. Some people tell me, well, Rafael, you never stop. Your lifestyle is your work. Yes, surely, I guess.
I know. Right? Yeah.
But physically, I did write a lot of poetry, for which is not bad, actually. Poetry under the influence, I call it.
is there any other thing?
Yeah, but actually, some of it is quite good, which will be published eventually. But yes, I then when I returned, I started playing around with cutouts and it kind of got me back into the groove of things. Also the fact that my son was born in 2005, and he kind of re-inspired me too. You know, there was just
kind
of mellow man. Fatherhood did it. It had a major impact.
Different priorities.
Well, yeah, it did. I mean, it caught me by surprise, but you know, love of something that I hadn't, something to love dearly that I hadn't felt in a while, really.
Great. So you got back into the work, and this is some of the, is this new, some of the newer work?
This is some of the newer work. This is also, this is my photographic part stuff. This is, I built a name for myself with photography, even though I was trained as a painter. The pieces that I had at LACMA, the Avant Garde in the 80s, were photographic. I used to build these maquettes, which were like mini movie sets. I had aspirations of maybe directing films or whatever, which in Hollywood a lot of people do. And I, like Fassbinder, Fellini, all those guys. And so back in the mid-80s, when I started building these maquettes and photographing them, which Robert Berman exhibited, at his gallery, I would do these sculptural little things, create these landscapes, miniature landscapes, and I would photograph them. So when I get back to doing photography, which is what you're looking at, I still saw photography as a tool to create things that were not just directly photographic, but, in other words, I collage over this photograph. Everything is mine. I took the photograph, and then I collage on top of it, these different things. But it reminds me in a way of what I was doing back in the late 80s, except it's a different approach to it. Instead of building things on a tabletop, like a miniature landscape, I was cutting things and gluing them on top of the photograph.
But it's still this physical process.
Yes, it
right?
is.
Yeah.
It is.
Yeah. So and
I don't know if that makes sense, but
totally. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
No, and what are we looking at here?
This is actually where I'm going lately. I guess this is a perfect example of what I was talking about. This several generations. I started with a drawing, painting, small painting. Which I then documented photographically. I printed it. I've documented it photographically. Then with Photoshop, I changed the color rendition, and then I printed it, and then I started drawing over it. And then as I drew over it, I saw other possibilities, and I started collaging over the painting. They painted.
Does the photo paper that you print on? I mean, is it?
It's flat. It's flat. So it looks. It's a watercolor paper type.
Oh, okay. So you print actually on like a traditional art kind of surface.
Well,
like.
They call it watercolor paper actually.
Okay.
And so it's opaque. So then I start. It's really exciting because you see all these other possibilities. I could have never seen this from just a blank piece of paper. No, if I use a blank piece of paper, I create these paintings. Which are pretty good in themselves, in their own right, I guess. But when I photographed them, and Photoshopped them, I changed contrast and color palette. Then I printed, and then I repaint over them and recollage over them. Then I see a whole different world.
Who is your first big artistic influence?
My first big art, I have to admit, is my son corny, but Pablo Picasso. It was a great impact. My father loved him. Mind you, my father was a Spaniard who fought in the Spanish Civil War with Franco, with a fascist, and then became a socialist.
Wow.
So it's interesting that he should like Picasso because the
Guernica is the statement against
But those guys back then, and my father was born in 1903, he was old enough to be my grandfather, so he was drawn to classical antiquity and you know, those guys like neoclassical stuff. But he became a communist later in life.
And he still liked Picasso, though. That's
and he still liked Picasso, which was like obviously tabooed by people such that of conservative leaning, such as my father was early on. Then he became very much of a... He switched gears,
after
the Cuban Revolution, actually, or soon after, I don't know.
Were you born in Cuba?
I was born in Cuba.
When did you come to the United States?
I came in 1967.
Okay.
Yeah, as a kid, as a baby, really, and I've been here ever since.
And so you showed with Berman back.
He showed after the Avant Garde in the 80s. People were calling me from New York. I was like in San Francisco. I show with Andres Serrano's also, the Piss Cries guy. Oh, yeah. They often had to say no relationship because we showed up more than once together. And he's actually half Cuban, for what it's worth. And then I, and then after that, what was the question again?
Well, I was just saying, like, you showed Berman.
Yeah, and then after, then Berman picked me up, Shoshana Wayne stole some of my stuff. I was very popular all of a sudden.
Well, showing in a museum when you're young,
I was one of the youngest, along with Jean-Michel Basquiat and Keith Haring and Sidney Sherman. We were like the youngest.
Wow.
And then I showed at the Alternative Museum in New York.
Okay.
With Andres Serrano too, and a number of others, and then San Francisco Camera Work, and a lot of.
Where have you been showing lately?
Lately, I've been showing at, I showed at Fathom Gallery in downtown. They're not major galleries, but they're all right. Fabric Magazine, Phil Tarly wrote a really interesting article about me. Tanya M. Ladin wrote a fantastic article in Vice Magazine. I really am very honored and very proud of that one. She did a great job.
So what are we looking at here?
This is a piece that actually owned by Phil Tarly, the art critic. This is one of his favorite pieces. And this is, once again, this is actually my photography. What you're looking at, the background is a painting. One of my paintings, I put it flat on a table, which I used to do back in the 80s. I would create this landscape on top of tables. So I took one of my paintings, I put it down on the table, and I created these little sculptural pieces that are out of clay, and I placed them on top of the painting. Then I photographed it. Then I photoshopped it a little bit as far as the color palette. And this one's pretty straight on, just printed. I didn't mess with it afterwards.
Nice.
But it's funny because this took me back to my time back in the late 80s, mid to late 80s, when I was creating these maquettes on tabletops. I took my paintings, I thought, hey, this got possibilities. I created a table. Of course, I photographed it from an angle or from the top. So what you're looking at is one of my paintings in the background, which I've exhibited. I also had a show at the Neutra, I should say.
Okay.
Yeah.
So 30 years ago, you're at LACMA. What would you tell a kid just getting into the art world now, the differences between then and now?
Between then and now? Yeah. Oh, man.
In the art world.
In the art world, back then, it was, in LA in particular, it was pretty glamorous, actually. A lot of miniskirts, black miniskirts. There was a lot of food in the galleries. I remember that, and champagne. It seemed fancier.
It's
silly to start from that, but I remember
That's great. I remember food. I remember beef carvings on galleries on La Brea.
There was a lot less people in the art world. A lot less people call themselves artists.
Tiny number. Yeah.
Yeah. Now everybody's an artist. I mean, everyone I talk to is an artist. It becomes ridiculous. It's become much more fashionable, I guess.
Do you have any advice for younger artists?
For younger artists, to do it if they really feel it's a calling, and not to do it because it's cool. You know, that's the only thing I can think of at the top of my head. Right. To do it because it is a wonderful thing to do. Actually, even though it's difficult. Oh, Jesus Christ. I turned it off, but let me turn it.
You gotta mute your phone. If you have to take the call on the air, you have to.
No. I can't talk to you right now. Sorry about that.
that was not planned.
That was not planned. And I turned it off. Okay, but
it's all good, man. It's all good. So, do you have any shows coming up right now?
I'm part of this show with one of your favorite Shepherd Fairey.
Oh, cool! Shepherd Fairey. Yeah. Oh, well, he's a well-known artist.
Yes, he is. At a place called Castelli Art Space in Culver City.
But not Leo Castelli.
No, not Leo Castelli.
Okay, Castelli Art Space in Culver City. When's that up?
That's going to open up November 30th.
November 30th.
And I have a show in Berlin right now.
Wow! Berlin.
Yes.
Berlin's hot.
This is
right
actually
now.
Something that I'm very proud of. Actually, I'm glad you asked me. It's called the Inter Art Foundation, and this guy by the name of Carlos Iglesias brought my work to the attention of what's her name, the curator. Forget her name right now. Anyway, I'm sorry. But anyway, it's at the Art Inter Art Foundation. It's in Berlin. It's called 49 Artists, and it may be traveling to Tokyo. It's a nonprofit organization that that is basically founded by very well founded right now, and it's supposed to travel throughout. They're making it up as they go along.
Well, congratulations on your continued success. Rafael Serrano, thank you for joining us here on Modern Art Blitz. We'll be back right after this.
Great, thanks.